Bunbury, known to some of you. And it was really funny because when Steve and I flew together, he seemed like he was straight out of high school. And he used to sit next to me while I was quaffing large trays full of business class food for my lunch. He'd be sitting there eating out of a plastic bag with plum beans and almonds. And I thought there was something weird about him. We enjoyed many, many hours in the cockpit together, and we had some great chats, and it's good to see him here too, his brother also. A lot of people, a lot of familiar faces here for me. I came to faith 16 years ago from a dark nothingness. I didn't believe in anything, I didn't have any spiritual upbringing, I had all the addictions, and my life was just full of toys. I had a good income that provided me with things that would fill this hole in my soul that I thought I could fill with belongings and addictions and stuff. And it wasn't until I nearly killed myself that I realised I could only fill that hole with God, because it was a God-shaped hole. And Michelle helped me to see that when I met her just days before I was going to take my own life. And a lot of you are aware of that story. But since then, as an atheist, I've come to faith in the simplest possible way, because I believe I have to keep it simple for me. Because as many different churches as I've been to and as many different scholars as I've listened to, quite often a lot of their message goes over my head because I don't feel spiritually mature enough to deal with it. And it's really important to me that I understand what I understand. So I came into faith through the Seventh-day Adventist Church, because Michelle came from a loving Seventh-day Adventist family here in the Southwest. And her dream was always to be baptised into the church that her mum and dad brought her up into. Now, a lot of people know the circumstances that made that difficult for her, being a victim of sexual abuse within the church, which has now been beautifully dealt with, thanks be to the Holy Spirit and God. But I actually went to church the first time, because she said she wanted to go back to her church and be baptised, and I said, well, I'm not into religion, but I'll go with you to be your bodyguard. Because for her, church had become an unsafe place, for obvious reasons. And so my first foray into a church was as my wife's bodyguard, into a church. And I walked in there full of bravado, like a front row forward in a ballet school. And the pastor of that church is sitting in this audience tonight, today. I'll talk about him a bit later. But I walked in with a certain amount of cynicism and a lack of faith and a lack of belief, but a yearning to know more. Because when you get your life to a point where you don't live anymore, you need to start looking for answers, or you just zip it and it's all over and over. So that's what I did. I thought, well, I'll go to this church, and the pastor who I mentioned earlier, who's sitting here, I thought the church was friendly enough. I was impressed by the multiculturalism and the joy that the people were expressing in their relationships to each other. And I sat down, and there was all the preliminaries, the three hymn sandwich, as we call it. I pray anybody who's never been to church gets used to a three-hymn sandwich soon. Because it's quite tasty. It's quite tasty once you get to know it. And so I came in and I sat down, went through the three-hymn sandwich, all the preliminaries, and the pastor got up and spoke. And within 10 minutes I was nudging Michelle. And I said to her, have you been talking to him about me? And she said, no, I've never met him. And she said, what? I said, he's talking about my life. And she said, I have never met him. I haven't seen him. And I'm thinking, my God, I'm looking at this guy, pumping it out, and I'm thinking, you're kidding, right? And I'm looking up and down the pews, and they're all sitting there. Some are looking at their watches because my pop-up was coming up soon, and they were still talking. And I'm looking at them thinking, aren't you guys getting this? I now know they weren't meant to. It was me that was meant to. Because his sermon went through me like a truck. And so as we walked out of the church, he was standing there to shake our hands, as pastors do. And he said, "Oh, it's good to see newcomers to our church. Hope you come back." And I said, "Oh, not likely, mate." He said, "Oh, why is that?" I said, "I'm a shift worker, so I don't get Saturdays off very often." "Oh, what do you do?" "I work at Brisbane Airport." "Who do you work for?" "Qantas." "What do you do?" "I'm a pilot." Because the minute you say you're a pilot for an airline, you've got to lock down for an hour and a half to listen to people ask questions. And so I try not to talk about it, but... And he said, "Oh, really?" He said, "I was the head of the union at the Qantas jet base in Sydney. Do you know so and so and so and so?" And I said, "No, I don't, but you were at Qantas." And he said, "Yeah." And I said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "I was in the surf club, used to drink beer and have a good time and everything. And then my missus dragged me along to hear John Carter at the Sydney Opera House, and I've been goo-go ever since." So John Carter spoke to him, so he could speak to me, so I can speak to you. That's how God works, you see. And I believe in miracles. I really believe in miracles. So the next Saturday came along, and Michelle said to me, "What do you want to do today?" She said, "We can go to the beach or something." I said, "Don't you want to go back to your church?" And she said, "I didn't think you'd want to." I said, "Yeah, okay. Okay. I'll just sit there and look after you, make sure you're going to be safe." Went along, pastor gets up, another sermon hits me like a train. Then I'm hooked. And within 6 weeks, both Michelle and I put our hands up to be baptised and to be married as well, because at that time we were living in the dreaded Sin, which is a suburb of the Gold Coast, just outside of the Gold Coast. And we were in the throes of starting a new relationship through the brokenness of our past. God used her to save me from my addiction and from suicide, and he used me to help her recover from her sexual abuse and put us together to do some good things, which we've been trying to do ever since, with God's grace. So, when we put our hands up to be baptised, well, first of all, the pastor came around with his lovely wife every Wednesday afternoon, 2 o'clock. And they used to do Bible studies with us. And we were going through all manner of things in the Bible. Some of it was just going straight out of my head, and I'm smiling like, "Oh yeah, I understand. Laodicea, lukewarm, yeah. Spit it out, vomit it up, yep, yeah, I get it." Pretending and saying it and wanting to say all the right things, but not really understanding. And then we got into the part where I started to realise what sin was about. And I realised that if I go any further in this Bible study, that the relationship I have with Michelle is going to have to be put on hold because I'm not married to her. And I said, "Oh, this is the hard bit for me, because I'm at the stage in this Bible study where I know that you're telling me that Michelle and I are living in sin. But I've waited for her my whole life. And if I've got to decide now between faith and my relationship with Michelle, this will be our last Bible study." Serious point in the crossroads. Because that's how I felt. I didn't know enough to feel otherwise. And God impressed him enough, because he could see the love that we had for each other. He knew the respect that we had for each other. And I believe, without dropping him into a bucket of hot water, that God impressed him to say, "You know what? Maybe in the eyes of God, you two are already married. Let's just keep going." And we did. And if he hadn't done that, I wouldn't be here now talking to you. So God moves in mysterious ways. We have to be flexible for Jesus. We have to be adaptable for Jesus. We have to be approachable for Jesus. We must never have our faith become a barrier between us and those who are dying to have what we feel that we have. And so, we put our hands up to be baptised, and I said to the pastor, "How do we deal with this whole marriage thing?" He said, "Well, we'll baptise you and marry you on the same day." He said, "We'll marry you first, and then we'll baptise you." And we thought, great. So we get to start our marriage off as Queensians. And it worked really well. Except for one thing. 10 months prior to our marriage and baptism, Michelle became really, really ill. Really ill. We couldn't work out what it was. Throbbing headaches, instability on her feet. Couldn't get into an elevator without wanting to vomit. We tried everything to find out what was going on. For 10 months she lived in debilitating pain. Really, really, really debilitating pain. And here's the woman of my dreams, and I'm feeling like I'm going to lose her, and she was so ill. And we couldn't find a specialist anywhere that could diagnose what was wrong with her. And after 10 months of this, because we put our hands up to be baptized, we were being attacked, like you wouldn't believe. After 10 months of that, it got to a stage where after several medical appointments that seemed to find what was going on but didn't, and several prescriptions that prescribed drugs that were making it worse rather than better, I ended up ringing a neurologist who'd been treating her and saying, look, if I don't get her to hospital now, I'm going to lose her. She was scheduled the next day to have a bunch of investigative things done. The first thing was a lumbar puncture. The second thing was an ultrasound the following day. And then an MRI on the Monday, and then come back and see me on Tuesday to talk about the results. It's important you remember the order of those procedures. The first one was a lumbar puncture. I took her into emergency in the hospital where she was scheduled to have those procedures done the next day. She was a mess. She was lying in a fetal position on the kitchen floor and she could hardly move. Every time she looked at the light, she saw red rings around her. So when I took her to the emergency, a Russian doctor on exchange was the only doctor on duty, and he had a very broad Russian accent. And being the judgmental Aussie that I was then, I thought, great, I just want a really good Aussie doctor to deal with this. I don't want some guy on exchange from another country. And Dr. Bob didn't know I was thinking that. And he said, what's going on? We talked to him about it. He said, okay, I've got to tell you, we need to do some stuff. And I said, well, it's okay. She's booked in for a lumbar puncture tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. And so he said, well, I can do that now. And so he decided to prep her for a lumbar puncture, and he wanted to ring a neurologist beforehand to make sure that he was happy with him doing this procedure. And he checked with the neurologist, and the neurologist said, yes, go ahead and do that now. And they had it prepped in the cubicle in the emergency, and they brought in the table with a very long needle, which was going to puncture her spine and check the spinal pressure. And as he was about to do that, he stopped and put the package down and looked at me and he said, I don't like doing this unless I know what's in the head beforehand. I wanted to have a scan before I do it. So he wheeled her off to have a scan. And when he came back 20 minutes later, he got me to the light board in the nurse's station in the emergency. And he showed me a picture of her skull that showed 20% of the internal workings of her skull was filled with pressurized blood. She had two massive head bleeds between subdural hematoma between the brain, skin and the skull, and her brain was being pressurized into the top of her spine. And had he released the pressure with a lumbar puncture needle, she would have died instantly on the table. So God was there. So he then said, we've got to get her up into a ward straight away. This lady's in a very critical condition. So they booked her into a ward. It was getting very late at night, around midnight. I went up to the ward and the nurses said, we'll take it from here. I said, not without me, I'm not leaving here, I'm staying with her. That's it, no negotiation. Pity West Australian hospitals weren't like that. So they said, all right, we'll put a mattress on the floor, you can stay alongside her, and I did. The next morning, a neurosurgeon came in and had a look at the scans. Beautiful lady, and she said, right, we've got some work to do urgently. So they took a whole heap of bloods, and because of the malfeasance of the doctors who prescribed her blood thinners before, they couldn't operate on her because she would have bled to death. So they said, it's going to take a week for us to get her bloods back to normal so we can operate. So for a week she was on 30-minute observations from nurse and staff. She was in a critical condition. She was almost comatose. I had the horrible task of bringing her children and saying, you know, your mum's in a really bad way. And they're all over here and we're over there, and it was pretty awkward. It was was horrible. And then the pastor from the church came every day to us, and he prayed with us every day, and he sat with me because I was pretty distressed. The love of my life was about to die. Everything I'd lived for, the whole reason I stopped killing myself on the 18th of August 2006 was about to leave me. And I felt like I was at the end of my tether. So we prayed every day. He came in, he was hours with us there every day. And every day we got more blood tests done and nothing was happening. The bloods weren't getting any thicker. The neurologist who prescribed the procedure came running in the first morning after she checked in, dropping F-bomb after F-bomb because he realised he'd made a mistake that could have killed her. And he was more interested in about losing his licence than he was about her condition. So for day after day after day, the procedures kept getting done and nothing was changing, and it was getting worse and worse and worse. And the pastor came in every day and he said to me one day, "Would it be all right with you if we anointed her?" And I said, "I don't know what that is. What is that?" He said, "Well, we pray for her, and I anoint her head with the oil, we bring the elders in and we have a prayer." I said, "Well, we need to ask her. I don't know what you're talking about." And he said, "All right." And I asked Michelle, and she said, "Yeah, that'd be good." And she was a mess, absolute mess. She was in more pain than you could poke a stick at. And the time was set for the anointing to happen. And it was a Saturday afternoon. And the pastor and the elders from the church that we became members of came to pray with her. Now that morning before then, the neurosurgeon called me out to the nurse's station before the anointing. And she said, "Look," she said, "the bloods we're taking from your wife are not showing any signs of improvement. It'll be at least another 10 days before we can operate." And I said, "She's not going to last." And she said, "There's nothing more we can do. We can just keep her calm, keep her under observation and watch over her." And I went back in and Michelle said to me, "What did the doctor want?" And I said, "No, nothing, only just routine." She said, "You promised you'd never keep anything from me, what is it?" And I told her what the doctor told me, which was, "You need to steel yourself for the worst. She may not make it, and if she does, she'll be an issue." And I went in and I had to tell her because she put it off. And then she said to me, she said, "You know what? If I end up being a vegetable, you need to farm me out somewhere and be able to live life." And I said, "You've got to be kidding, you know." I said, "Even if you never recognise me for the rest of my life, I'll quit my job and I'll look after you for the rest of my life." And she said, "You don't have to do that, we're not even married." And I said, "We'll fix that as soon as we get out of this truck, we're going to be married. As soon as we get out." And I started to talk to the pastor about that. I started to say to him, "You know, I want you to marry us as soon as possible. Yeah, let's get a well first. Let's get a well." So that was the morning that we had that conversation. And that afternoon, about 4 hours later, the pastor walked in with the elders and they prayed over her and they anointed her head with oil. And she was lying there with her eyes rotating in her head. She was in a terrible space. And I remember getting on my knees and I made a promise to God. I said to God, "Lord, if you keep her alive for me, I promise I'll spend the rest of my life in your service." And then I realised I made a huge mistake. I put a condition on God's life. And I said, "I'll take that back, Lord. I promise to commit my life to your service from this point on. But if you could keep her alive for me, that would be the greatest gift you could ever give me." I knew enough to know that. Thank you, God, for that. So then, as the anointing was just about finished, there was a knock on the door. And I went to the door and answered it. And there was a little rotund guy standing there with a phlebotomy trolley. He was coming to take her midday bloods. And I said, "Can you wait a moment? We're just doing a procedure." And he said, "Sure, I'll wait." And he waited and we finished praying. And then I opened the door and let him in. And everyone recognised him. He was the youth pastor from the Marine Church, the neighbouring church where we were going. "What are you doing here?" What's that? "Oh, I'm a phlebotomist. I do that in my spare time." "Oh, wow. So what are you doing?" "Oh, I'm here to take this lady's blood." "Oh, okay. What were you doing?" "Oh, we're just anointing her." "Okay. All right." So I said, "All right, honey, what are you getting your blood?" Pastor, elders, I'll go down to the car park. I'll say goodbye and we'll go to prayer. I'll be back in 10 minutes. He took her blood after the anointing. I came back. The lady was almost in a coma, was sitting up, brushing her hair, smiling. And I looked at her and I said, "What?" She said, "I've got no pain. Within 10 minutes of the anointing, I've got no pain. Are you kidding me?" "No." She said, "I feel normal." And that night we decided we'd sit and write letters to her children in case she didn't make it. And the bloods that were taken after the anointing went to the lab. And the next morning at 6 o'clock, the neurosurgeon came in and said, "You must have friends in high places because your bloods have just come back normal and we can't work it out. We're going in." And here she is. She was in surgery for an hour and a half. The neurosurgeon put four holes in her head, drained the blood out, and cared enough about her not to shave her head but to plait it and braid it, because she knew that Michelle and I were going to get married the minute we got out. She cared enough. And we were the talk of the hospital. Everyone was talking about this couple in the ward. I never left her side but to go home and grab some clean clothing and bring it back for her. And the pastor never left my side. And the Holy Spirit never left my side. And I'm struggling to find a moment in my life where the Holy Spirit has ever left my life since or before. So, then, during the period she was in hospital, my divorce was approved. And I said to the pastor, "I'm divorced, I want to get married as soon as we get out of hospital." 10 days she spent in intensive care, waiting for everything to be right. And she was released on the Thursday, and I said to the pastor, can you marry us on Saturday, baptize?" He said, yeah, I'll fill in all the paperwork, where's your divorce certificate?" I said, "No, I haven't got that yet." He said, "Well, I can't marry you without a divorce certificate, I've got to sign it." I said, "No, I'm divorced, I've got the letter from the solicitor here." He said, no, I've got to have to sign the certificate." And I said, "Oh, you don't have to, just marry us." He said, "I've got to do it that way." So I said, "All right, I'll get the certificate." He said, "It's only day after tomorrow." I said, "I'll get the certificate." I rang my lawyer and I said, "How do I get a certificate?" "No, you won't get one for 6 weeks. It's got to go through registration time." And I said, "Can't you pull some strings?" He said, "No, I can't. All I can do is make a request, but it won't happen. It's never happened." And so when Michelle was home on the Friday morning and we were going to have our ceremony on the Saturday, I left home at 8 o'clock to drive an hour up to Brisbane to the family court to get our divorce certificate. And I said, "I'm not coming back till I get the divorce certificate." She said, "I'll see you in 6 weeks. I parked the car at 8 minutes to 9. I ran across through an atrium into this massive, big family court building. It's sad to see such an edifice to misery. And I walked to a table in the middle that had a concierge. And I ran up to this man who'd been there for probably 50 years wearing the little gold keys on his lapel. And I said to him, quick, where do I go to get a divorce certificate?" He said, "Excuse me." I said, "I've got to get a divorce certificate. Where do I go?" He said, "When was your decree?" I said, "It was Thursday last week." He said, "No, you don't. The divorce certificate will be mailed to you. You don't come in and collect it. It's got to be registered and it's got to be tied up." I said, "You don't understand. You don't understand. No. And he said, "No, you don't understand. It won't happen." And I said to him, "Is there anyone, I don't mean to offend you, but is there anyone above you that I can go to? Is there anyone who can arrange this for me?" I was almost going to offer him $100. And he looked at me and he said, "Just a moment." He opened his drawer and he grabbed a pad and a pen and he put it on the desk. And he said, "What's your name?" And I said, "Graham Wood." And he said, "What's your phone number?" And he started writing my number down. He said, "What did you say your name was?" I said, "Graham Wood." And he reached into the desk and he pulled out a wad of envelopes that thick with a rubber band around it, and my envelope was on the top with my divorce certificate in it. He wouldn't have seen it if it wasn't on the top. And he looked and he said, "I think this is your divorce certificate." I said, "Yeah, it is." And I took off. And an hour later, I was home with Michelle and I drew up a dummy divorce certificate to play games with the pastor. The idea of fools kept out with all these labels hanging on it. He came to verify it. I said, "Here it is." He said, "You can't do that. You're not going to pull all the way to mine." I said, then I showed him the real one. And the next day we were married and baptized. and it was beautiful. So I believe in miracles.
Amen.
And I've seen hundreds of them, because when we dedicated our lives to serve God, we put ourselves in recovery ministry, and in doing that, we got to work with thousands of broken people from all walks of life. And we've seen miracles brought in their lives. I've seen a drug addict with a major addiction who slept in his car and used to sell drugs to support his addiction come through a period of recovery, who is now a pastor, a church pastor, leading other people to recovery. Miracle after miracle after miracle. I've seen people on the edge of suicide. One man, for example, somebody in America sent me a message. Can you go on Facebook, on this guy's Facebook page? He lives in Arizona. We think he's about to kill himself. I spent an hour and a half talking to him, chatting to him. He was about to be arrested. He was a drug addict and he had stolen money from his parents, and his parents had rung the police, and he was a three-time loser and it meant going to jail for life. And we prayed and prayed and prayed, and he'd never prayed before. And then he disappeared for 18 months and he came back into my life. And I said, where have you been? He said, I've been in rehab for 18 months. I booked myself into rehab. I said, you didn't go to jail? He said, no, for some reason my dad withdrew the charges. And he said, now I'm giving my life to God. But he said, I want you to know that if you hadn't taken the time to contact me from Australia, I would have been dead. I was going to kill myself. God works these miracles. I've seen it. So over there, I'm an atheist. I had no faith in anything, not even myself. God brought me to the edge of a cliff where a lot of people stand right at this moment. And as I was leaning out of the cliff, his fingers tucked in behind my belt and just pulled me back. And he showed me that there was another purpose for my life. Another purpose that could be used to bring glory to him. Because I realised that God never wasted it. And I know there's some people in here who are now having their first church experience because you told me. And I want you to know that you're in a safe place. Because if you're feeling troubled, if you're feeling like, I'm not good enough, I've been too dark, God will never accept me. Rubbish. Because I had no qualification in theology. I had no outstanding knowledge of the Bible. I'm a greenhorn in it. All I know is that the church that wanted to get me to come to faith through Revelation and Daniel, through end time prophecy, was struggling. And they struggled because I needed to know who Jesus was before I made any decisions about the end time. So I studied Jesus. And in the study of Jesus, I realised that a beautiful man who walked among lepers, who took the hierarchy of the synagogues to task, who upturned the money changers' tables in the temple, who brought to life those who had died, who healed the broken, had done the same thing for me 2,000 years before I was born. And when I realised that Christ died the worst, most unspeakable death to give a filthy porn addict like me a second chance, I couldn't walk away from him. I want him to speak to your heart. I want you to know in your heart that the same God I love and worship through his son Jesus Christ is your Jesus Christ too. And he will be speaking to you. So we need to go on and understand what's happening. I'm going to talk about another miracle that's only just happened. A bit later on, I'll probably close with it. But I want to say that in this time since I found myself becoming skeptical of institutions, both faith-based, charity-based, government-based, corporate-based, when I realised that I was losing my faith in everything I used to trust, I had to look elsewhere for answers. And in leading myself down that journey, I found that there were inconsistencies in truth through the systems I had loved and trusted all my life. And so I made that video, because none of it made sense to me. I honour anybody who makes a decision, no matter what they decide to do. I just felt I needed to make my decision without being coerced, and so I made a video. And when I made that video, flooded with messages from people in abject despair. Many of them who didn't know Jesus. Many of them who thought they were the only ones alive who felt like I did. Many of them who had already lost loved ones to suicide because of it. Many who were dying inside and planning their own end because of it. Many have lost their homes. Some were sleeping in cars with their children. And they kept saying, "Can you please be my voice?" And I'm thinking, who am I to be anybody's voice? All I have is a happy marriage and a God who loves me. It's proven it time and time again. I was an atheist. I rejected everything faith-based in my life. I rejected everything religious in my life. And there are good reasons for that, because corporate religion does an awful lot to destroy the character and image of God. It does. But you know what? It does that because we're part of those of us who go to church. We're all part of that process. And we're all humans. And corporate churches are led by human beings who feel that they have a moral obligation to do what they have to protect the corporate church. But sometimes that comes at the expense of the faith message that we're meant to carry to the people who need it. And so, I thought I have to speak up. Cut a long story short, I knew that my posting of that video was going to cost me my 53-year career. I wasn't ready to leave it yet. I knew that the time was coming when that would be over. And I did it at my own hands. I knew I left the company no room to maneuver. And then I was told that if I kept my mouth shut for another 18 months, my lawyer that told me that I'd probably get a large settlement from the airline. But I'd have to say nothing for 18 months. And so I decided that was taking money to dance with the devil. And I wasn't going to do that. Because there's all these people now who are saying, "Please keep speaking." What am I going to do? Am I going to say to them, "Look, I'd love to keep speaking, but I can't because there's a big juicy payout waiting for me in 18 months and I don't have to wait it." Who owns all the cattle on 1,000 hills? God does. Who owns everything that I ever need and knows exactly what I need and even better than what I want? God does. So after consultation with Michelle, I wrote my resignation, I pressed the set button and I heard that sound off the computer. And that was the sound of my career going down the aeroplane toilet because it makes the same noise. Press the button and everything goes. I cried like a baby. And I still cry virtually every day, but not because of my pain, because of the pain of the others that keep contacting us who are bleeding. And I don't want anyone to bleed. I want people to come to Christ. So I'm not an activist. I'm not a revolutionary. I'm a very reluctant evangelist and I make no bones about it and I make no apologies for it. So then I was invited to a rally and I've never been to a rally before. And I accepted the invitation and I walked up on the rally stage on the Queensland, New South Wales border in front of 17,000 people, not knowing what I was going to say. And I prayed and I asked Jesus to walk up with me. There were a lot of strange people there. I have people coming up to me saying, holding up the phone, "Excuse me, Jesus wants to talk to you." "Excuse me?" "Yahweh is on the phone and wants to talk to you." "Why?" "Here's a document you have to read, and when you step up on the stage, you must read this document." "I'm not going to read that document. I haven't read it. I haven't got time to read it. And Yahweh talks to me here, not through here. So go away." So then they turned it into a camera. You now have to talk into this camera and tell Yahweh that you're refusing to talk to him. I just pushed it away and went up onto the stage. It was rattling. But I needed Jesus then more than ever because I knew I was under Satan attack. I walked up on the stage and the first thing I did was say to people, "Well, I know this may be foreign to some of you, but I'm not going to do anything until I pray." And when I prayed, it was from my heart. And I heard 17,000 people yell amen at the end. And so I talked a bit about my faith. And then the rally organisers said, "That was great, that was really good. We want you to come back to another rally on such and such a day." And I said, "What day of the week's that?" And they said, "It's a Saturday." And I said, no, I can't do rallies on a Saturday. I'll keep Sabbath, it's very important to me." And they said, no, it's all right, you'll be doing good work, you'll be helping people, so God will smile on you." I said, "I've got to pray about this, I can't do that, it's on the Sabbath." And I said, "Oh, okay, well, let us know on Friday." And I rang them on the Friday and I said, "Look, I don't think I can do it." They said, "Look, it's all right." This was a national, international rally that was set up to be on the one day at one time, and all the posters were done. And they said, "We want you to speak, we've changed the date to the Sunday." And I thought, "You did that for me?" And they said, "Yep, we want you to speak." So I spoke and I walked up and I told the story of a courageous Seventh-day Adventist boy who went to war in Okinawa, who was a conscientious objector who became a combat medic and saved, he says in his book, 150 soldiers by lowering them down one at a time on a cliff from a Japanese held position in World War II in Okinawa. The movie was made called Hacksaw Ridge, and Desmond Goss was the only non-combatant, conscientious objector ever to win the Congressional Medal of Honor in America. An incredibly brave man, but a man of faith, whose motto was, that night, as he was lowering people down the cliff, exhausted with bleeding hands from what seemed ropes being scorched through his hands, lean back with exhaustion, hear the deathly cries of his friends who were half buried in the sand being bayoneted by Japanese soldiers, wounded men, saying, "Just one. He'd get up and he'd go and get one more, and he'd lower another one down and go, "Just one more." That's how I feel. One more. Just one more. And I told that story and everyone cheered. And I talked about the faith and why it's important to keep the Sabbath. It's the only commandment. The fourth commandment is the only one that God says, remember. Keep it holy. You don't change it to suit the business arrangement of ancient Rome. I've got to keep it holy. And then I was asked to another big rally in Sydney. 350,000 people was on a Saturday. And I said, I can't do it. I prayed about it. And 2:31 morning, I sat up all upright. And clearly, God had spoken to my mind and said, "It's okay, you can go there because it's not a rally, it's a church. Go and preach to the people." So I went with Michelle, and it was amazing. 350,000 people, faith-loving Christians wandering around handing out wonderful books, many of whom are sitting up the back, many of the books are sitting up the back at the table, and I urge every one of you to go home with a handful of stuff. They were handing them out to people who wanted them. They weren't just being shoved in the bin afterwards. People were going up and asking for these books. The Great Controversy, Steps to Christ, hungry people. Craig Kelly, the politician, was sitting in the speaker's tent next to Michelle and I reading The Great Controversy. And she said to him, "Don't start at the beginning, read the last six chapters first and then go back to the beginning." She said, it'll absolutely drag you in. And when I stepped up onto the stage, for 5 minutes, there were 350,000 people chanting my name. And we couldn't speak until the chanting died down. Now, I've got to tell you, that comes from Satan, that stuff. Because that can really bring you down. If you get puffed up by that kind of behavior, you're gone. And I thank God that it made me feel nervous, not from a point of view of speaking out to thousands of people, but I felt like this was a trap that was being set for me, and I shrank from it, and I thank God for that. But I told the Desmond Goss story, and I talked about the validity of the Sabbath, and the people gravitated to it, and they were praying amen, and now I go to rallies, and there are Sabbath keeper flags everywhere. Since we started speaking at the rallies, more than 100,000 great controversies have been handed out to people who've been asking for them. 100,000. People are hungry for faith. They're frightened and they're scared. What we love about doing the rally noise is not the speaking in the front, it's the 4 hours we spent, Michelle and I, at the bottom of the stage, hugging and praying with people who are queued up for hundreds of metres just to come and be prayed with us. I mentioned on Facebook one night that if I'm going to be in Canberra another week, I might see if we can baptise a few people in Lake Billy Griffin. People heard that all around Australia. People drove from all around Australia because they thought I was going to baptise. Somebody set it up that we could have a baptismal font at the top of the hill in front of the new Parliament House, so they put this big inflatable pool up there. When they got it there, they realised they had no water. What were they going to do? There was 1.2 million people about to show up at the baptismal font. What were they going to do? And as they're scratching their heads, the senior inspector for the Australian Federal Police came up and said, "Excuse me, what's that for?" "Oh, it's a pool." "Yeah, but what's it for?" "We want to baptise people." And they said, "Oh, okay." They said, "Well, we can't find any water." She gets on a two-way radio and a federal police truck with a water tanker on the back turns up and fills the font. Water. Now, what people didn't know was that two nights before then, a large amount of money was put on a table at Camper, where all the people were staying. A large amount of money was put on the table to kill me. I had a contract put on my head. The police heard about it and they took me away and they, for my safety, and they investigated. It's an ongoing investigation. And they said on the 10th, and the big rally was on the 12th, "You need to get out of town, we can't guarantee your safety." And so, at 4 in the morning after being at the police station for 4 hours, I said, "I just want to go to bed, can I please go to bed?" They let me go to bed, and they said, "Tomorrow we'll organise some of your friends to take you out of Canberra." And when I met my friends, they said, "You ready to go?" I said, "I'm not going." Because that's what they want me to do. That's what Satan wants me to do, he doesn't want me to speak. And as I got up to the stage, like at every rally, there's someone comes up behind me and says, "Now, we don't want you talking about God, we don't want you to pray." So I get up and I say, "I've just been told not to talk about God and not to pray. Well, if that upsets you, stiff chair." And everybody cheers. Everybody cheers. And you think, why are these people cheering? And so we spend hours hugging people and praying with them and having them cry on our shoulders, and I've had dozens of atheists come to me and say, "I don't believe in God and I hate religion, but I can't go to sleep at night unless I hear you pray on your live videos." And I say to them, "What does that tell you?" They said, "I don't." They say, "I don't know." And I say, "God wants you in relationship with him. Think about it." That's what people are hungry for. They can't be wrong on the Mark McGowans and the Scott Morrisons of this world. They know there's got to be something more. Many of us here are Christians. Probably quite a few aren't. Those who aren't are here because they get adrift of what's going on. They want to know more. And you that are here, you get adrift of what's going on. And some of you want to teach more. So what I want to impart to you is a way of doing that. It brings people close in without frightening them off. Because corporate religion has done an awful lot to paint a picture of God that's not true. Corporate religion has painted God as a punishing, belligerent God who wanders around in a big white robe with a clipboard and a red pen marking your name off the roll and all the discretions that you've had in your life and all the sins that you've committed yourself to. But that flies in the face of what the Bible says about God. So when I'm talking to new people who want to know how do you get into the Bible, I just say, "Well, there's a lot of that stuff in there that you're not going to understand. But the stuff you do get will go straight into your heart where it needs to be." Because I found in my walk of faith that all the knowledge in the world is of no use to people who don't apply it. We can have a head full of scripture, but if we don't apply it in our lives, it's just empty words in an empty book. We have to realise that we're probably the only Bible that a lot of people will ever read, and in this time in our history with things so critically evil, we need to be visible in powerful ways. So for me, I'll use my daughter as an example. Let's have a look at what the Bible says about God. And so I say to her, go to 1 Corinthians 13 in the Bible. We did this over the telephone. She was over here and I was in New South Wales. Go to 1 Corinthians 13 in your Bible. But before we read that, know this, the Bible said that God is love and that we were created to love and be loved. So God is love. Love is God. Okay, so read 1 Corinthians 13. Most of you know it. Love is patient, love is kind, love keeps no track of wrongs, love is not puffed up. Every wedding you've ever been to, you've heard those vows. And then I said, replace the word love and read it again, but replace the word love with the word God. God is patient, God is kind, God keeps no track of wrongs, he's not puffed up, he's not proud, he doesn't seek his own. Oh wow, that's how God is. Wow, he's not such a bad guy after all. No, maybe he's not. Now, we're expected in our walk of faith to try and be as much like Jesus as we can, knowing that we're never going to be perfect, but we've got to try. So replace the word God and the word love with the word your God. You can do it with me. Graham is patient. Graham is kind. Graham keeps no track of wrongs. Graham is not puffed up. And she said, oh my God, I've got a long way to go. And I said, yeah, but we all have. We're all in this boat together. And I said, so that's who God is. He doesn't have a clipboard. Now, a lot of people say, oh, he does. I mean, sin is a way of convicting us that we're not close to God. And so, I say to people, the first words that came out of Christ's mouth and John the Baptist's mouth when they started preaching was repent. But if you say that to a bunch of people at a rally, they'll laugh at you. Who do you think you are, Billy Graham? But I say it to them in different ways. I say, you ever get up to go to the Word of God, then you go back to bed at 2 in the morning and you can't get back to sleep because something's eating away in your mind. Have you? You can't get back to sleep. I used to call them the night demons. Those dark, shadowy things that whisper in your ear. Remember when you stole that thing from Bunnings? Remember when you looked at that pornography? Remember when you walked out of the cafe and didn't pay for the cappuccino? Remember when you had a cappuccino? Decaf. Remember how you used to come up with your neighbor's wife? Remember how you said those hurtful things about that guy because he wounded you? All those things are there to show us that our character needs to God. So how do we deal with that? We own it. We accept we're responsible for it, and we give it to God. And God burns it in the sin incinerator. In the incinerator. I have to remember that when I write that down. God gets rid of it. And people say, nah, that's what that is. Proof of the pudding's in the eating, it's right there in the Bible. King David broke every law in the book. King David, the beloved of God, broke every single commandment in the book. He lusted after his neighbor's wife. He arranged for the husband to be killed on the battlefield to cover up the pregnancy, the illicit pregnancy that he was responsible for. He shot everything about his mother and father in the foot by his actions. He dishonored God. He lied. He murdered. He committed adultery. The whole lot. But David went through a metamorphosis. And some of the greatest writings that came from his hand came after he committed all those sins, and he fell flat-faced on the floor and he begged God to forgive him. Continually. And God did. How do we know he did? Because after David died, if you go to 1 Kings, you read the story about Jeroboam. Jeroboam was the king who took over after David. And the prophet went to Jeroboam and said, God has asked me to give you a message, Jeroboam. And he said, what is it? He said, you are nothing like my son David, who did nothing wrong in my sight. And Jeroboam went back and said, are you kidding me? Did nothing wrong? He broke every rule in the book. Every single rule. What do you mean he did nothing wrong? Well, hang on, there's two explanations. Either God's got amnesia, or he really does tell the truth about what repentance can do for you. He really proved in that moment that everything David repented of was blotted from the book of life. He was free of that. And David knew it. And that's why David is the beloved son of God. God proves it in Scripture. So he's forgiven everything I've repented of. If I walked up to 300,000 people and said, repent, they would all shy away. But when I tell a backstory in that way, they get it. Because it's palatable. It sounds real. And so I sleep well at night. Apart from the thing that still gets me up at 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 in the morning, most men in grey hair can testify to that. I go back to sleep, but it's well with my soul. Because I know God has forgiven me and I trust him because he's the great promise giver. So I get them to understand that. Then after 1 Corinthians 13, the obvious question is, okay, I want to have a character like that, but how do I get it? And I take them to Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. If you've never read a Bible before, people make a note of these, or you'll be able to get references to them later. 1 Corinthians 13 will tell you the character of God. Matthew chapter 5, the greatest sermon ever preached on the Mount by Jesus Christ himself, tells you how to live a life to get that character. Blessed are those who know they are spiritually poor. Blessed are those who mourn. You know the verses? So they're all laid out there. Each one of them is done in order that you must complete one before you can move on to the next one. It's done in sequence. There's something else sequential about the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. First you've got to mourn, then you'll be comforted. And mourning isn't grieving the loss of your cat that just got run over, or your dad that just died. It's mourning the fact that you've stepped away from God. Now my pastor, who's in this audience today, who I mentioned earlier, I rang him a couple of years back and I said, I'm a bit worried. He said, what are you worried about? I said, I feel like I've drifted away from God. And he said, oh really? I said, yeah. He said, how do you feel about that? I said, I'm worried sick about it. He said, thank God. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, if you weren't worried about it, I'd be really concerned. But the fact that you're grieving that you're not close to God makes me feel like you have hope. So that's what that mourning means. It's a grieving of not being close to God, because when I'm away from God, even though I'm broken and I make mistakes every day, when I feel like I'm out of his sight, which I never am, it's just me thinking that way. I feel lost and alone, and I don't like being there. So the Sermon on the Mount teaches us how to be humble, how to be sincere, how to be courageous, how to be a peacemaker, how to be compassionate, how to see the love of others and give it to them as well. Everything is made round to go around in the law of God. Every single law of God, every single design process on the planet that we live in is circular. You receive, you give. You receive, you give. You receive, you give. You breathe oxygen, you give out carbon dioxide. Plants say thank you, they make more oxygen for you. It's a circle. And in relationships, we live in a circle of love and trust which must never be broken. For if it is, it takes a long time to bring it back. The circle of love and trust is what holds community together. That circle has been broken in our country. The circle of love and trust in Australia and on this planet has been destroyed, but not utterly, because communities will bring it back. So she's got a picture of God, now she's got a recipe for how to live a life that brings you into favour with that beautiful God. Then we get to the part that most people cringe about, the Ten Commandments. Exodus 20. Go Go to Exodus 20, because Matthew 5 is now giving you the tools by which you can apply to Exodus 20 to make your life good. What's Exodus 20, Dad? The Ten Commandments. Oh, no, that's too hard. Nobody can ever live up to that. But hang on, what if the Ten Commandments is actually like an operating manual for your life? What if you actually kept all of those Ten Commandments and that meant that your life functioned the way you were designed to function, according to God's design law? And you think about it, the first four are about honouring God. I'm a jealous God, he says. What he's saying is, I created you. It's me. It's nobody else. Don't worship idols. Why would you worship a chunk of wood or a block of gold carved in an image when you can go directly to the source? What a waste. Who are we kidding? If we're worshipping an idol, we're not worshipping God. That's not God. God doesn't want us to worship him through an idol. He wants us to worship him in relationship through Jesus Christ, his Son. Don't use his name in vain. Why would you use the name of your Creator as a curse to serve the betterment of Satan? And the fourth one, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you will labor, and on the seventh day you will rest, for that is the Sabbath, the holy day of the Lord your God. And in that time you will do no labor, and you will spend your loving time with him and your family. It's the only one he says remember. There are other forces in the world who sought to change that in order to claim the authority of God in their particular faith. That's what's going to bring the world undone if we're not careful. We have to keep the laws of God as best we can by living in the testimony of Jesus Christ, by loving each other, by mixing with the lepers, by speaking up when we need to. And the last six commandments are about loving each other as we would have them love us. First four are about honoring God, the last six are about honoring each other. Now you think about that, how that works as a design feature. If you lust, that lust feeds your guilt and shame, which keeps you awake in the middle of the night, which feeds the night demons, which has you thinking, I've got to repent. So isn't it better to refine your character so lust doesn't appear there, because you are all of a sudden satisfied? Because when we lust, we're not satisfied. When we steal, we're not satisfied. When we tell lies, it's because we're hurting and we want to punish others. We're not satisfied. Every single one of those last six are the things, if they're not dealt with properly, keep us awake at night, which means we don't get to function the way God designed our bodies to function. So why would you want sin in your life when it creates opportunities for Satan to grind away you with an ant grinder? Why would you want it? But we still want it. Why? Because sin's kind of attractive. Sin's easy. There's a little voice in one ear saying, don't do it. And there's another voice saying, hey, you've got nothing to lose. Who cares? You've seen it in the cartoons, the Disney cartoons. Angel on one shoulder, demon on the next. But this is the kind of lie that Satan is. He'll say to you, it's quite right. It's the pornography. It's not like you're having an affair. And it'll be all right, she won't know, it'll be between you and me. And then straight after you do it, he's back in your room and see, I told you, you're weak. You'll never stand before God. You belong to me now. He's a liar. And he's at the foundation of everything that's going on in our country at the moment. If you don't believe that we're not locked in a battle of good and evil, and your eyes need to open just a little bit more. So then we need the fruits of the Spirit, Galatians 5. If we live with the fruits of the Spirit in conjunction with understanding who the character of God is, in conjunction with seeing that the laws of God are actually there for our betterment, so that we function the way we design. And if we apply all those through Matthew 5, the Beatitudes, the recipe for being a good person, then the Bible has given us already everything we need to have the power. ask for that allows us onto the lifeboat at the end of time when we can go. So is that all you've got to do? No, you have to invite the Holy Spirit in to guide you and lead you to parts of the Bible that you can get to understand. And if you approach that with love and compassion, with faith, with an open mind and an open heart, you'll get to a stage later in your life where you will start to feel, I'm qualified to board this lifeboat. You know what, I may be right, I may just get there. Because we need to remember that there was a thief who died on the cross next to Jesus, who defended Jesus at the moment of his death. Now, he didn't have a degree in theology. He probably heard Jesus speak a few times. But Jesus made him a promise with his dying breath. There'll be a mansion for you in heaven. So for any of you who are wondering, do I need to be a Bible scholar to avail myself of what Jesus is freely offering us today? And I'm telling you, you don't. I'm telling you, you just need a desire to make a start. Amen. There is one of the Beatitudes in one version of the Bible that says, blessed are those whose greatest desire is to do what God requires. The desire to do it. Doesn't mean you do it. Blessed are those whose greatest desire is to do what he wants. So that's where I take people into the Bible. And that's all I need to do. The rest they can learn along the way. But we have a golden opportunity. Those of you who are in faith and those of you who have wandered into this building wondering what you're walking into, you both have golden opportunities. You who are in faith already have a golden opportunity to seize upon a harvest that is absolutely bulging with fruit. We've seen it with our own eyes, haven't we? With our own eyes. We've seen grace and forgiveness poured out in abundance over so many hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of hurting people in a world they feel has let them down. Now, if you're one of those people and you walked into a place like this for the first time, you now have a golden opportunity. I'll tell you why I sleep at night, despite all the messages I get talking about the impending evil. I understand what the book of Revelation means, pretty much. I have a feeling that me and many of us are called to be trumpets for the angels that are sending that message out loud and clear. We need to start warning people that the Babylonian system, that system which is fed by people like Bill Gates, Papal Rome, the World Economic Forum, all those things are real. And that's a Babylonian system which is designed to coerce, control you, and take you out of the relationship with Jesus. And you need to come out of that system. And you need to do that by standing in your truth. Have that truth be the truth of the Lord Jesus. And stand in strength, knowing that the arm of God is there for you, and it will protect you. It will protect your front, and Jesus will protect your rear. I've put it to the test, and it's worked. I've been in the belly of the beast for 7 months, going to the rallies in Canberra. For a man of faith, it was like walking into the belly of the beast. Death threats, abuse. I'm every degree of Freemason that ever lived. I've been accused of the most unspeakable crimes, all of which I know aren't true, by people who believe every dark, shadowy thing that's fed to them on the internet. That's how Satan works. Now you can be a part of that, or you can step out of that and say, I'm going to live in the light.
Amen.
And I choose to live in the light. And I choose to live in my truth. And I continue honestly with all of my heart, if you choose to stand there in that place with me and all the others who are seeing that as well, you will have peace that surpasses all understanding. You will have a faith that surpasses all understanding. And you'll look at the dark things coming on the news and you'll say, well, that's interesting. But I'm okay, because my big brother is Jesus. He's my sovereign Lord. He designed me, he created the laws by which I live, and he will guide me to that place where we can all go home. The miracle I wanted to end with, how long have I been talking, by the way?
About
1 hour and 15. Gee, that went quick. I put up a post the other day called The Miracle of Helen. Can you put your hand up if you saw it? Okay, a fair few of you. Well, Helen is a beautiful lady who lives in Perth. She and her husband, Max, are dear friends of ours, have been for 16 years. Max and Helen were instrumental in helping me understand what God was all about through their friendship with Michelle. And we went to have dinner with them about 10 days ago, and it was great. We had a lovely meal together, but she's been ill for some time. And they were packed up, ready to move to a little farm in Coconut near Hartley. The truck was coming on a Monday, and on a Saturday night, Helen was in Max's arms as they were lying on the bed praying together, and she had a seizure. And it was a very bad seizure, and then luckily the ambulance was there in minutes. Not like in some cases where ambulances have taken 12 hours later. And she made it to the hospital, a good hospital. And they both had Jack. And the ambulance took her in and told him he had to wait outside the hospital at midnight. He couldn't go in because he hadn't been vaccinated. And they took Helen in. And they took some x-rays and scans, and they found out she had a massive glioma, which is a gelatinous form of tumour, which doesn't sit on the surface of the brain in any way, but it sends glutinous chemicals down into the core of the brain to disrupt everything. It's one of the most invasive brain tumours. And this one was the biggest the doctors had ever seen. The biggest. They said, this is the biggest. And the odds weren't looking good. And so Max went home and he prayed and he contacted us and we prayed together. And we asked the Lord to protect her. He was desperate to get in to be with her, but because he hadn't been vaccinated, he wasn't allowed in. But he managed to negotiate 1 hour pre-op, and they said they were going to have to operate. And they said, we have to open her skull and remove the front right-hand quadrant of her brain, which contains most of her memory and all of her emotional personality. We're going to have to remove it. If she survives it, you'll be living with a stranger. And she will be living with a stranger. So after nearly 50 years of marriage, you will both be strangers and have to spend the rest of your lives together. But he managed to wangle a visit 1 hour pre-op before she went under the knife. And they put him in full PPE after visiting her so that he didn't infect anybody, even though he tested negative on drug. And they hang a large yellow sign around his neck that said unvaxxed. And they paraded him with an escort through the hospital, and the escort stayed with him until he finished talking to his wife, unable to remove his mask, unable to touch her, unable to kiss her, unable to hold her. He was allowed the next day, half an hour after the op. And that's it. We thank God for FaceTime. But Helen went in, and we were probably some of the last people she spoke to, and we prayed with her. And we said, a lot of people are praying for you. And we love you. And I started to cry because I realised that was the last coherent conversation I was ever going to have with a dear friend. Because the surgeon's knife was going to take away everything about her that we loved. And we prayed, and she cried, and we were shattered all night. And I put it on Facebook that she was going through a bad time. And as a result of that, hundreds of thousands of people around the world were praying for her. All over the world, every single country on the planet virtually, we were inundated with messages. She went into the surgery, came out of the surgery after nearly a full day under the knife, Her son, who had been vaccinated, who just got over COVID, was allowed to go and visit her. And as he walked into the room where she was lying with her eyes closed, she said, "Hello, Max." And he said, "It's not Max, it's your son. You sound just like your father in your footsteps." And she said, "Mum, hello, Dad." And then Max came in and she said, "Hello, Max," with her eyes closed. "Hello, my darling, how are you?" "I'm good, I'm very good." "Are you okay?" "Yes, I'm okay. I really love you, darling." "I love you more." "Now I love you more. Now I love you more. I love you more, I love you more." This goes on in the academy and everyone. "I love you more. I love you most." And we'd realised that a miracle had been performed. Because she hadn't lost any of that. We don't know what the prognosis is from here on in. But we did a FaceTime with her this morning. It was just like she had a haircut. Everything else about her was the same. Now that's another miracle. And people around the world are looking at that miracle and they're saying, "Wow, how can this happen?" Well, it happens because we worship an amazing God. Amen. Who has a future for us beyond our comprehension. So I wonder as I close, I will take questions. But I wonder how many of you are a bit apprehensive at the moment. How many of you are thinking, "Can this be as good as he says it is?" How many of you are wondering where you stand with Jesus Christ? How many of you are wondering where you stand with your country, with your neighbours? How many of you want to embrace something that may just be the answer to everything that keeps you awake at night? How many of you are dying to bathe in forgiveness? How many of you are dying to live in the grace and mercy that we come from the sovereign Lord? Feel the grace and glory of God. Just come and stand in front. That's my grandson. Don't be afraid. What I'm offering you is joy and serenity.